Oh boy, time to complain about music I don't like. Looking at the year-end chart, I won't lie. 2021 was a pretty big step down from 2020. The year of the pandemic was one of the best years in music history, with dozens of gems, and at worst, just kind of boring or pointless. This year, however, the bad stuff definitely stands out a lot more. I mean, I'd still say the year was solid overall. We did get plenty of good stuff that outweighed the bad in quantity by a pretty decent margin, but that's a story for another time. For now, here are the top 10 worst hit songs of 2021. TikTok is the chaotic neutral force in social media outlets. As such, the quality of the trends it pushes are gonna be all over the place, and that definitely applies to music. All you need is a funny and a memeable segment, and you're already in the running for a massive hit. Kinda like with Vine, but now with even more diversity of opportunity. Sometimes that's a good thing, and other times we get this.
She's a runner, she's a track star. She gon' run away when it gets hard. She can't take the pain, she can't get scarred.
Now I will give credit where it's due. Even though the song is subpar, the meme is pretty funny.
Meme! Approved!
You can't deny, the clip that kept getting reused was pretty catchy, and I can see why it got traction. So if that's the case, why is it on this list? Well, that's just a snippet. Most people probably haven't heard it the whole way through, and,
The dirt you left don't turn into dust, it don't move.
Yeah, I can't stand this dude. It's not even that his voice is particularly bad. Mooski, yes, that's his actual name, is a perfectly fine singer. It's just that he has no melodic consistency whatsoever. The notes he sings are all over the place, and it gets really distracting and annoying really fast. His attempts at harmonizing and displaying emotion just can't mask how vocally directionless he is. It sounds like he freestyled the vocal melody while someone had a gun to his head and told him to keep singing. It also doesn't help that it has the same crappy mixing as one of those 2016 dancehall demos, except worse because the guy singing over it isn't nearly as reserved or experienced as someone like Drake. Although, trust me, we'll get to him in a minute. But yeah, this one is a dud. One-hit wonders are less common these days, but Mooski might just end up being one. Speaking of over-singing... The Kid LAROI strikes me as someone who has potential, but hasn't really made his mark just yet. Stay was a good song, even if it was essentially just Diet Blinding Lights, but other than that, I can't really say I've heard anything from the guy I'd add to my playlist, and this really isn't helping things. This song embodies everything unappealing about the white guy with an acoustic guitar whining about a breakup song, especially because The Kid LAROI took direct inspiration from Juice WRLD. And don't get me wrong, the guy's a legend and died far too tragically young, but let's not pretend like he didn't have some pretty juvenile stuff in his early career. Lucid Dreams, for iconic as it is a lot to stomach if you're not in the mood for it, and Without You is basically that song except stripped back, removes the Sting sample, and has a much more amateur vocal performance. I mean, obviously The Kid LAROI didn't have as much experience, but that doesn't make his voice any less irritating.
And it hurts for me to think about what life could possibly be like without you.
Like with Mooski, God, I love that name. It's not that he's a bad singer per se, it's just that the inflection he chooses to put on each syllable that he sings just comes off so whiny and petulant. It reminds me of Simple Plan.
How could this happen to me without you?
I can at least say the mixing is pretty tight, which is more than I can say for the last song, but I still think this one is worse purely because the singing is just way more obnoxious. Hopefully in the future this guy will make more music like Stay and less like this. Out of all the songs in this list, this is probably the one people are gonna disagree with the most. A lot of people seem to like this one, and I can see why, but just hear me out. Most of Ariana's output is solid, including her most recent album, which you should listen to, but this one always rubbed me the wrong way. I remember hearing this on the radio a lot, and the more I heard it, the more off-putting it became. The main issue here is that the sultry vibe would have clicked a lot better in a major key. The whole thing just sounds weirdly tense in a minor one, especially with the weird tempo shifts at the last quarter of the hook. Something like Love Me Harder remains really sensual and seductive in spite of Grande looking like an amateur Twitch streamer in the music video, but POV feels like it has this sort of rigid energy that never gets released or resolved, which really doesn't mesh well for this kind of song. And this is coming from someone who usually prefers songs that are in a minor key, since it feels like the stakes are higher and often makes for a more satisfying listening experience, but this just ain't the way to do it. At least not for me. Look, the song isn't terrible by any means, and Ariana is still a very good vocalist, but I just can't vibe with this one. Anyway, now that I've talked about boring music theory stuff, let's make fun of Drake. I'm too sexy for this girl, too sexy for your girl, too sexy for this world. You know, when all the memes mocking Drake for being the most fragile being alive started blowing up, I thought, you know, maybe we're being a little harsh, you know? I mean, is all this scorn and vitriol really necessary? And then I remembered he was responsible for this monstrosity. Honestly, the whole album was a joke, and even a lot of his fans agreed with that sentiment, which should tell you just how half-assed the effort was. But there's a reason this one was pushed into the limelight. Sampling Right Said Fred is already basically an admission that you really want to create a meme more than an actual song. And that was clearly intentional, since Drake has basically become the Illumination Studios of music at this point, and I'm not even the only one to make that comparison. The beat sounds like an ice cream truck from hell. Drake is at his most asinine, and oh yeah, the song is over 4 minutes long. Future's hook is catchy to the point of melting your brain, which I suppose was the intention, and I guess makes the song slightly more bearable in the grand scheme. But otherwise, yeah, this is a disaster. Can't wait for Drake's next album, where he puts effort into 7% of the tracklist and becomes a void of creativity for the rest of it. So, a lot of people really don't like country music, basically clubbing all of it as tractors, beer, girls, and cornfields, and, you know, I don't think that's really fair. Even if you ignore the Jason Isbells of the world and focus solely on the mainstream, there's still a handful of things I could point to as being worthwhile country. But then again, I am often reminded that some stereotypes exist for a reason. Fancy like Applebee's on a date night, got that bourbon, so you stay with the Oreo. If you believe in reincarnation, then Walker Hayes is the most surefire proof you can get. Because let's be real, this dude is literally just Luke Bryan 2.0, but with even less of a personality somehow. If this song is any indication anyway. Honestly, there's not too much I can say about this particular country song, other than it sounds like the drunk karaoke version of Viva La Vida Loca. Although one line that sticks out to me is Walker Hayes bragging about how fancy taking his girl to Applebee's is. I mean, you could have chosen Legal Seafoods or the Cheesecake Factory. Hell, even TGI Friday still would have been better than Applebee's. And you know, even if it isn't meant to be literal and is just a metaphor for yeehaw sex, it's still probably going to be a pretty underwhelming experience anyway, so checkmate. Gotcha, bitch! Oh, Olivia. Why? Now we're starting to get into the stuff that I really don't like. For someone as talented and filled with personality as Olivia Rodrigo, this song is insultingly sappy and tedious. It's the sequel to Jar of Hearts by Christina Perry that no one asked for, but somehow even more of a depressing slog. At least to me, the main appeal of Olivia Rodrigo is rooted in her impressive ability to take teenage breakup songs and recontextualize them into more interesting and diverse packages, tackling several different genres and taking influence from people like Lorde, Avril Lavigne, and even the Beatles themselves. And I thoroughly enjoy all of her other hits for that very reason, except for Traitor, specifically because rather than pushing the envelope forward, it not only stagnates but devolves into the stereotypical ugly melodramatic schlock that the more cynical listeners would interpret all teenage pop as being guilty of perpetuating. Listening to Traitor makes me feel like I'm listening to a teenage girl having a mental breakdown over FaceTime, talking about the guy who dumped him while I begrudgingly pretend to act like that wasn't an extremely obvious outcome from the get-go. Next. This is Put Your Records On by Corin Bailey Rae. It came out in 2006, and while not exactly a masterpiece or anything, it's a pretty cute song with a lot of charm. Not too far off from someone like Natasha Bedingfield. And, you know, the main appeal of Natasha Bedingfield is just how natural and happy she sounds just to be alive. So what would happen if, oh, I don't know, you made a cover of the song slathered in reverb, removed all the charm from the original, and turned the last 30 seconds into audible hellfire?
You can't hurt anyone anymore.
Obviously, all music is subjective, and as such, what makes or breaks the quality of a song or an album is going to vary depending on the person. Personally, being a music production major, I'm obviously pretty biased, though this isn't completely concrete. Adele performing over a generic piano ballad still creates an above-average song, because, well, it's Adele, the passion shines through. But oftentimes, even a good performer simply can't do anything worthwhile with garbage production. Case in point...
What a nigga gotta do for your number? Shorty came through with that hair so good, I said, fuck it, I ain't using no.
2021 had a few disappointing follow-ups from some of the biggest artists of 2020. But none were as jarring as the drop in quality from Megan Thee Stallion, a really talented rapper plagued with horrendous production on a lot of her singles this year, the worst of which being two of her biggest ones, unfortunately. Bonnie has an ear-gratingly repetitive hook and choppy bits of moaning with little to no sense of melody or purpose. It's pretty much just the girl boss version of the Whisper song. Then we get to Cry Baby, and instead of moaning noises, now we have baby noises, a creepy piano and a tacky DaBaby verse. Now, if they were going for something like horrorcore, then maybe this could have worked, but we're not talking about clipping here. We're talking about the woman who makes music for girls ages 15 and up on TikTok. Why the hell does her production sound like a bad remake of the Luigi's Mansion soundtrack? Oh, and as if that wasn't enough. Two piano chords and a Kodak Black ripoff rambling. Yay. Only saving grace is it's short. I'm so lonely. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we've discovered negative first world problems.
Molly, 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 Molly.
Billy and Phineas should sue.
We just trying to catch a good time.
This sounds like what would happen if a SoundCloud rapper with 10 monthly listeners decided to make a trap remix of the Back at the Barnyard theme song.
Yeah, say that you a lesbian girl, me too.
You know what? At least Way Too Sexy was supposed to be funny. This is just sad. I actually like this song a lot, but it got popular off of Dream fan art, and that is inexcusable. AJR. So, remember that one Panic at the Disco track 2 years ago, which was a pretentious, faux elegant, incompetent, insufferable mess? Yeah, that one. Well, AJR, aka the band responsible for quite possibly the worst album to ever exist, essentially just remade that song with even more incompetent production and even less likable performances. Because as much as it came across as a pompous douche, at least Brendan Urie's voice doesn't make me want to slam my head through a wall. Every single audible choice on this song feels like it was made specifically to piss me off. From the rubber pianos, to the overprocessed horns, to the fake bombast in the beat, to the crowd chanting, to the guy saying,
metronome.
All these small aggravations coming together to make this giant glob of torturous audio. And look, I know the wonky and obtuse nature of this song is intentional. It's supposed to reflect the sentiment of life giving you shit and being forced to truck through it. I've seen a few people compare it to the Joker for that very reason, essentially giving it a pass because, well, it's supposed to sound obnoxious. You're meant to connect and relate to the song via your own worst impulses. But the problem is that AJR just does not know how to create an atmosphere dissonant enough to do that kind of thing. Nor can they write anything to justify debauchery like, say, The Weeknd can. Going back to The Joker, what makes that such a compelling movie is how you get to watch the slow and cruel downfall of a man originally just misunderstood and poorly nurtured become a monster through losing what little stabilizing factors they had left in life. Bang is the equivalent of a middle-class college student failing his classes after getting drunk at one too many frat parties, rather than doing any self-reflection, instead choosing to streak naked in the parking lot shouting quotes from Rick and Morty at 3 a.m. There is no doubt in my mind that Bang by AJR is the worst hit song of 2021.
Here we go.
Anyway, glad I got that out of the way. Next is the best list, where I get to talk about music that I actually like.